Hello, my name is Christine Liu. I'm doing a PhD in neuroscience at UC Berkeley, and I get paid around $37,000 a year. And I'm not special. This is something that almost all STEM PhD students in the US can get. In the US, STEM PhD programs are actually paid because doing a PhD is a lot more like doing work than it is like being a student. But too many students don't know that this is an option. If this is the first time that you are hearing that you can actually get paid and pay no tuition to get a PhD in science, you're in the right place. My goal here is to demystify a little bit of this process, compare STEM PhD programs to master programs in the US and abroad, and then tell you a little bit about ways that you can earn money while doing research as an undergraduate or as a postbac. So grad school is a lot like doing a job. You go in and day out, and you work on a research project. You don't really actually take that many classes. You might teach a few, but grad school is not what most people think it is, particularly in the sciences. First off, almost everyone gets paid in a STEM PhD program in the United States. I just want to give a little bit of a disclaimer. I'm definitely not a grad school or admissions expert. I'm mostly just speaking from my own personal experience. Please keep in mind that I'm just coming from a US-focused perspective and a neuroscience perspective. Take that with a grain of salt. So first things first, to get a PhD in STEM in the US, you actually do not need a master's before you start. This is different than Europe, let's say, where it's actually required, it is a prerequisite that you have a master's degree before you start the PhD. And this is because in the US, STEM PhD programs take around 4 to 7 years, in which the first 2 years are typically what you would learn in a master's program. So it's actually not that big of an advantage to come into a US-based STEM PhD program already having a master's. It's great for many ways in that you have a lot more independent research experience and you might have a better idea of what you want to research. But in terms of just the actual requirements, you don't need a master's. That said, this means that in the US, master's programs don't actually tend to be funded. So if you want to do a master's, either as the terminal degree, so not getting a PhD at all, or you want to get a master's before you figure out if you want to do a PhD, I highly encourage you to look into master's programs in other countries where it is more common to have funded master's programs. And there are definitely funded master's programs in the US as well. So just make sure that when you apply to any postgraduate program, that it is going to have funding covered. So the funding comes from different areas for PhD programs. Money can come from a training grant that is given by the government to an entire PhD program. This is usually where the money comes from in your first year as a PhD student before you actually join a lab. The first year of the PhD is typically rotations where you sample around 10 weeks of 3 different labs, and then you finally choose the one that you want to spend the rest of your PhD in. And then at that point, your professor, the principal investigator of that lab, will be responsible for making sure that you're paid through either their grants or other funding sources. You might also be required to teach as part of your funding source, and this varies really widely between different programs. Another way to get funded throughout your PhD is to get scholarships and fellowships on your own that you'll apply for. And this is heavily encouraged, not just because it eases some of the financial burden on your program and your PI, but also because these are extremely prestigious and the way that science works, and honestly, probably most of life in prestigious institutions, is that the more you win, the easier it is to win. So if you have small scholarships on your resume already, it's going to be easier to get big scholarships, and so on and so forth. I will link a super, super helpful spreadsheet in the description where a bunch of different graduate programs at different universities all over the world and across many, many disciplines beyond STEM, so even English, history, all these different disciplines, how much students get paid. And so that will give you an idea of what a wide range stipends are. But for the most part, for the STEM PhD programs, it's gonna be from about $20,000 to $45,000 or so. And this totally depends on the cost of living in the area of the school, as well as how much funding that program gets. So even at Berkeley, we have students who are in different programs, let's say neuroscience and integrative biology, and the pay discrepancy there is huge. So when you're looking for programs to apply to, you start kind of by looking for PIs whose labs you're interested in, whose work really interests you, that you would want to dedicate a large fraction of your life to. But these PIs can usually take students from different departments. So even if you're looking at working for one professor, take a look at all the different kinds of programs that students enter their lab through, because it can make a huge difference for your graduate school experience if you are in a program where you don't get a lot of funding and you are expected to teach every single semester in order to get your pay. That is going to be a lot harder than being in a program where there's enough funding, where you only have to teach the number of times where it's truly beneficial to your training, and then the rest of the time you can focus on your research. So the funding packages vary a lot at different institutions, but basically you can get tuition for free, so it's waived, and you get a stipend, so a monthly payment in the months during the academic year as well as in the summer for some students, and also benefits. So I also get a pretty decent student health insurance package that actually covers dental and optometry and regular visits. And the UC system in particular also has great options for healthcare for people who are trans. Look into the benefits that are also being offered with a graduate program, because that often can be worth a lot in addition to the stipend that you're actually being given. Grad school sounds pretty good, right? I mean, there's totally lots of reasons not to go to grad school, and I can make another video for that. But now that you know that you can go to grad school and get paid the entire time, an okay-ish salary, definitely livable, at least for me, as someone with no kids, as someone who is able-bodied, also coming from a low-income background, like my graduate student salary is so much higher than what my parents were making. So I am super, super comfortable living as a PhD student. Now you might be wondering, how does one become competitive for a PhD program, especially these ones that pay a lot more? Typically some of the more well-funded programs are a little bit more competitive and prestigious. So one of the main things that's going to help you get into a graduate school program is previous research experience. They want to know before you come in that you are capable of dedicating a lot of your time to a huge research project. And the way you do that is demonstrating that you've already kind of done it before. And so there are several ways to do this. There are summer undergraduate research programs, and those I highly recommend. I'm actually wearing a shirt from the Amgen Program, which is one of the bigger programs across the US that funds students to do research for around 8 to 10 weeks at different universities and pays them several thousand dollars, houses them, feeds them, and provides a lot of really important training and mentorship. So I can't overstate how awesome these programs are. I did two of them when I was an undergrad. One of them was at my undergrad university, which was University of Oregon, and then another was at Stanford, which I did through a program called HHMI XROP. Basically, if you're interested in these programs, just Google REU, which stands for Research Experience for Undergraduates, or some version of summer undergraduate program with the university that you're in or a university that you would like to go to, because a lot of times people want the students to be completely immersed in the research experience. So it's not necessarily advantageous to apply to just the program at your school. You should cast a wide net. And also, I hate to say it, but one of the best ways to get into these undergraduate summer research programs is having previous research experience. Now, that's not true for everybody. These research programs are really great for students who are coming in from, let's say, a small liberal arts school where they don't have a lot of opportunities to do research. That's totally fine. You should definitely apply for these, even if you haven't had any research experience. But if you're serious about going to grad school, about starting a career in research, just get started doing research as soon as possible, wherever you are now. And the ease for getting a research position as an undergrad totally depends on the institution that you're at. So when I was at University of Oregon, all I did was I sent a cold email. So a cold email is when you just send an email to someone you have never talked to before ever, who has no idea who you are. I sent a cold email to the director of the Institute of Neuroscience as a freshman. So I was like 18 years old, had no idea what I was doing, but I conveyed basically what I would say was my desperation to get involved in research. And the director forwarded my email to the professors who had labs in the institute, and one PI emailed me back and we met and he offered me a position, and I stayed in there for the rest of my undergraduate career aside from one summer where I did research at Stanford. So cold email is a very, very, very common way to get a research position. There are other ways where you might be able to kind of be facilitated and helped into a research position. I highly recommend programs such as McNair, Mark, Meyerhoff. These are all great programs with a really incredible track record of helping students get into research programs and into grad school. So if there's anything like that that you're eligible to participate in, prioritize that. So at Berkeley, it is super hard for undergraduates to get a research position because so many undergraduates want to do them. So I've heard stories of people calling professors on the phone, emailing dozens of times, asking to come to lab meetings where they haven't even joined the lab yet. So basically just being persistent and genuine in your interest and desire to do research is really important. Tell your teaching assistants, so the graduate students that might be helping teach some of your classes, tell them that you're interested in doing research. Tell the professors whose office hours you're going to that you're interested. Tell your friends. Tell everyone and anyone you know that you're interested in doing research and going to grad school, because honestly, a lot of opportunities that are offered to people are through networking. And that's basically just people telling other people, particularly people that they like or that they're friends with or they know through something else, about opportunities. So start cultivating your professional network now, even if you're just a freshman in college or high school student, or you work in a completely different field and you are interested in science. Tell people. There are also ways where if you can get in touch with a principal investigator that wants to take you on and you are an underrepresented minority or you come from a disadvantaged background, which means that you're low income or first gen, homeless or disabled, you can apply for supplements to their grants that will specifically pay you. And also, if you're an undergraduate that gets work study, you can actually approach a lab to see if they might be able to hire you on as a work study student. And also, if you do qualify for work study, it probably means that you are low income, maybe you qualify for a Pell Grant, and this actually also falls under disadvantaged background for the NIH grant supplements. So you can also talk to these professors about applying for a diversity supplement to fund you. There are programs also called postbac programs, which stands for post-baccalaureate. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right. Post-bachelor's, post-baccalaureate, postbac programs. Basically, if you have already graduated from undergrad with a bachelor's degree, you are eligible for postbac programs where you can get funded to work on research projects full-time and prepare yourself for graduate school. So the NIH, the National Institute of Health, has a really great one. If you're watching this video and you feel a little bit freaked out, like maybe you're late to the game, please don't. It is never too late to start getting interested in doing research or having a career in science. I know a handful of people who had completely different careers before they started research. In fact, in some of the summer programs I participated in, there are people in their 30s and their late 20s. Like, it's really never too late. And one funny thing is that I know a handful of people who had pursued graphic design careers before starting a career in science, and the intersection of art and science is definitely something I want to talk about another time. You really don't have to have been a science nerd from high school or whatever to become a PhD in STEM. I want to share with you one story that I read when I asked my Twitter community about how they first learned about doing PhDs. So I asked, URMs, tell me about the first time you learned that a PhD was an option for you. I'm thinking of making a series of videos to demystify the grad school application process because not enough students learn about this stuff early on. This is a video. So Daniel Pimentel wrote that, working as a graphic designer out of undergrad, I had to create a brochure for a PhD fellowship for URMs. I was 23, I think. He actually had to create a video testimonial of all the fellows across all the different disciplines, and it gave him an idea of what a PhD entailed. And then since he was employed by that university, he was able to pursue a master's for free and then apply to the very same fellowship that he was making the brochure for 2.5 years later. And now, actually, he is a PhD candidate at University of Florida, and he is an incoming assistant professor of immersive media psychology at University of Oregon, where I had gone to undergrad. Go Ducks! So this is all just to say that the path to a scientific career might be winding, but there are so many people out there who want to make it a straight and barrier-free path for you. And I'm one of those people. I particularly want to help people who are underrepresented in the sciences or come from disadvantaged backgrounds to achieve this goal, because honestly, it's there for us to take, but not enough of us know about it. So please share this video with any of your friends who are interested in science, even if they haven't declared a major yet, because I want people to know that you can get a PhD, and you don't even need to use that PhD by becoming a professor or whatever. Like, I am an artist at heart, and I also am a scientist at heart, and I still have no idea what I want to do in my career, but doing a PhD has been one of the best things that has happened to me, and I want other people to have this opportunity because I was able to get paid a decent salary, at least for me, coming from a low-income background, to ask questions that just make me curious, and I'm given the tools at the cutting edge of neuroscience in order to just play, essentially. I mean, there's lots of pressures that go along with grad school, but if you're interested, there are people there who want to help. Also, get on science Twitter, because there are so many people who want to help others through this kind of cloudy process, but we just need people to get in touch with us. Because for many, many of the people that I know who are doing a PhD now, the moment they found out that they could get paid to go get a PhD was the moment everything changed for them. Thank you in advance for helping me get this message out by sharing and sharing your own stories and your own ideas for what we need to tell other people about. So thank you all for listening. I hope this was helpful. Leave a question in the comments of what you want me to talk about next. Share your experiences with other people. So information is everything. And let's get this information out there.